Here's my Lenovo ThinkPad T440s. I've owned this computer for just about 2 months now, and I've been very happy with it. I still use my HP 15 laptop, but now this has taken over as my main computer. Especially since I've been able to upgrade to 12 GB of RAM for free, just by swapping RAM sticks around with my HP 15. The HP 15 is now downgraded to 4 GB, but it still runs okay. Windows 10 on this computer works just fine, but one thing I haven't quite figured out yet is video editing. All the Windows video editors I could find are either not free or too complicated, so for a few years I've just been using iMovie. The problem is that iMovie only works on macOS. On my 2009 MacBook Pro, iMovie runs just fine, but it struggles a bit with 1080p 60 frames per second videos. So I installed macOS on my HP 15 laptop and iMovie worked fine there and rendered videos quite quickly. But now I have this ThinkPad T440s. And since I haven't found a video editor that suits my needs for Windows, I've installed macOS on it again. On my HP 15, I've actually gotten rid of macOS and I installed Ubuntu 19.04 instead. But I haven't had time to test out video editors there yet. I may try some Linux video editors in the future. Also, my 2009 MacBook Pro only officially supports macOS 10.11 El Capitan. I've had newer versions run on it before, but I decided to go back to El Capitan just so it works as well as possible with a supported macOS version without any hacks. But on both this ThinkPad and my HP 15, I can install the latest version of macOS right now, which is 10.14 Mojave. And now let's check out how it runs. First, I should show you some BIOS settings. So I pressed F1 there, and I like that I can use my fingerprint here. The reason I'm opening the BIOS setup is to show you the startup settings. Under boot, it has this option for macOS 10. If I leave it there, it doesn't really do anything, but it's not really supposed to be there. Every time I go here, I disable it just by pressing exclamation mark, but after a while it goes back up there. Doesn't really affect anything though, so that's not a big issue. What it does actually boot from is the hard drive, or in this case, the SSD itself. And it's smart enough to automatically find the Clover EFI bootloader. Otherwise, there's Windows Boot Manager, but we can boot up Windows using Clover just fine. It's set to only use UEFI, not legacy, but I did have to enable CSM support. CSM stands for Compatibility Support Module, and it says it enables legacy support even though I'm still only using EFI. Under security, I had to disable the security chip, also known as the Trusted Platform Module. Maybe it could be enabled, but I didn't want to risk anything, and I'm not using anything that requires the TPM in Windows, so I just disabled it. And also I disabled the anti-theft, which I can't even use. It requires some special enterprise corporate server or something like that. It's not for home consumers. Both the Intel anti-theft and Computrace are disabled. Secure boot also needs to be disabled, of course. Takes a while for some reason, but then it comes up. I have it set to boot to Windows by default, but I've already shown it in my other video, so we'll boot to macOS. I have Clover version 4.7.01. I can't use Touch ID, otherwise known as the fingerprint reader of this computer, but it doesn't really matter. So I had system preferences opened before. This is the native resolution, which is 1920 by 1080 or 1080p. macOS only supports 100% or 200% display scaling. 200% is used in their high resolution displays, which Apple calls retina displays. This 1080p resolution is a bit too high for 100% display scaling and too low for 200%. Because half of 1920 by 1080 is 960 by 540. Doesn't even work right now, but it's far too small for these days. But the UI elements on the screen are still visible. It's not that small. However, wouldn't it be nice if elements on the screen could be a little bigger? After installing a small application called RDM, which stands for Retina Display Menu, I have this menu here, which lets me switch to all the supported resolutions of this computer on the fly. And it even lets me select resolutions higher than this display. It lets me go up to 2560 by 1600, but that's 16 by 10 aspect ratio, or 8 by 5. So we can use 2560 by 1440, which is a little blurry, but it does work. However, what's the point of this resolution on this computer? It makes stuff even smaller. Well, this is why it's useful. We can set that to high DPI mode, which is 1280 by 720. And it is a little bit too big, but it's usable. It's almost as good as having an actual 2560 by 1440 display. I'm not sure if it shows up well on video, but it looks more than acceptable. It is a little blurry, but you have to get really close to notice it. So here's the About This Mac info. It's recognized as a MacBook Pro from late 2013. It shows the 12 gigabytes of RAM. I cannot show you the serial number because it's based on the serial number of a real Mac, so I can use iCloud features without any problems. But you can see all the other details there. It does recognize the 1080p screen. On storage, it just shows my SSD split up for macOS and Windows. Nothing of interest here. I got rid of macOS Mojave on my HP 15 because on this T440S, macOS Mojave runs a lot better. Its speed is the same, but a lot more features are supported. The one thing that isn't supported is the internal Wi-Fi. So I have my little USB Wi-Fi adapter plugged in. I don't need that on Windows, but I do on macOS. The drivers are some beta drivers for macOS 10.11, but they work just fine on 10.14. Battery percentage does work. It can tell between the two separate batteries, but it does show the average percentage. So that works fine. Sleep mode also works fine, as I briefly showed in my video about this computer in general. Brightness works fine, and so does audio. It gets quite loud, unlike my HP 15 where the audio was a bit quieter than it was on Windows. Even the mute light turns on. And when you plug in headphones, it automatically switches to them, unlike my HP 15, which on Mojave, you had to switch between headphones and speakers manually. I still have the inferior trackpad without proper track point buttons. I just put a piece of tape to help separate the track point buttons from the rest of the touchpad. But on macOS, really the only usable option is the trackpad, because trying to use the track point and just having your finger here makes the mouse still move. Whereas on Windows, when you use the track point, even if you move your finger a little bit here, it doesn't conflict. But if I install the trackpad with real buttons, the buttons won't be touch sensitive anymore, so you could use the track point under macOS there as well. But with this click pad conjoined with the track point buttons, only the track point is usable on macOS. The keyboard backlight also works, but that's not really controlled by the operating system, so it's not a surprise that it works. And that's pretty much it about macOS Mojave on this ThinkPad T440S. I've installed it by following a guide on the Tony Mac x86 forums specific for this computer, so I'll link it in the description. So as I was rebooting, the boot screen got stuck here, and it's been a few minutes already, so I think I should reset and try starting up again. In the meantime, I want to add some more details. Sometimes when I start up the computer again after using macOS to reboot back to Windows, this computer shows an error saying something like system variable storage is corrupted. Now it's booting up. But anyway, sometimes that error comes up and you can just continue. It doesn't really matter, even though I'm a little bit worried about it, but it doesn't seem to affect anything, so I'm not too worried about it, but it does happen sometimes, so I thought I should point it out. Also, both video output ports work fine, both the VGA and the mini display port, which is nice. The webcam does work. It takes photos in 720p. Sometimes the audio stops working. It makes a weird static sound and you have to reboot to get it back to normal again. Updates install fine with the special Rehab Man version of Clover Bootloader. I don't have to update it as often, but if there's a new version, I still have to update, of course. But after an update, some things like sound may stop working, so you have to run this command to rebuild the kernel extension cache and then restart, and then sound and other drivers will work fine again. And I think that's it. There's not much else to show. If you have any questions, you can ask in a comment. Thank you for watching.